April 17th, 2033, where do you think you'll be? Some of you are thinking, I probably won't even be here. That's a little less than 10 years from now. It is the date of Easter Sunday in the year 2033, which has very special significance for us as Christians, because it will be the 2000th anniversary of the resurrection of Jesus, right? He was 33 when he was crucified and rose from the dead. So the 2000th anniversary of the resurrection of Jesus, in a little less than 10 years. Now, last week, I was in London, England, get back on Friday, and I was at a leadership conference with 5,000 other leaders from all over the world, from different Christian traditions. We gathered at the Royal Albert Hall. It was quite an incredible experience. I've gone to this conference many times. But one of the questions that was asked of us leaders at this conference is, what's your vision for 2033? Because the 2000th year anniversary is a significant moment for us as the church to reflect on, how are we doing with the mission that Jesus has given us? The mission to make disciples of all the nations. The mission to build and grow healthy churches that bring people in, as we heard in our first reading today. How are we doing with that mission? And during a time of prayer, I had a kind of an image that came into my imagination, and I want to share it with you. I had an image of fishing boats on a beach, kind of like this. So some of them were up on, there was about six of them. Some of them were up on stilts, some of them were on in the sand, some of them were very well maintained, some were rusty and had peeling paint. But the view that I had was from the sea. So rather than the sea behind them, it was like I was on the sea looking at these boats on the beach. Beached fishing boats. And there was a group of people around the boats, and they had their back to the ocean. They were looking at the boat, and they were talking with each other. Some of them were arguing with each other. A few of them were fighting with each other about the fishing boats. And meanwhile, behind them, in the sea, you could see this great school of fish were swimming in. So that was the image, and I'm sure you get the meaning of it as it applies to the church, that sometimes we're looking at the wrong things, and we're missing the very heart of the mission that Jesus has given us, to be fishers of people, to go out to the deep water to let down our nets for the catch. The very things that we built as means to fulfill the mission have taken over the mission. The mission, in fact, is not to catch fish. The mission is to maintain the fishing boats on the beach. Meanwhile, there are many people in this world of ours who are hungry for God, who have a spiritual hunger in their hearts. It's always been the case. But today, especially in the present landscape, there is incredible spiritual hunger. But for most people, they do not see the church as having any significance for them. Why? Because we're facing the wrong way. You know, our greatest gift as a church is the person of Jesus Christ, who in the gospel today says, I am the way. You know, Philip says, we don't know the way. And Jesus says, I am the way. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. That's a Hebrew way of saying, I am the true way to life. I am the true way to life. The life that people hunger for. And it's our mission to bring people to encounter this Jesus, to bring people into his church, and then to have our church overflow to transform the world. About a year ago, our parish pastoral council went through a process, and we worked together to define a vision statement. It was a short statement to talk about what kind of church do we dream we can be through God's call. And this is what we come up with. Well, it just disappeared. There it is, back again. It's playing peekaboo. To be the heart of Dartmouth. It's a vision. To be a community that is caring and compassionate and inviting and a community in which people encounter Jesus. And then just like a heart, it brings blood in and pumps it out to bring life. That's our call to go out and bring life. I'm reminded of the words of Pope Francis, who said this about the parish. In all its activities, the parish encourages and trains its members to be evangelizers. It is a community of communities, a sanctuary where the thirsty come to drink in the midst of their journey, and a center of constant missionary outreach. A center, the heart, of constant missionary outreach. That's what we're called to be. Now, this weekend, we're starting a three-week preaching series on everyone's favorite topic. Can you guess what that is? Yes, it's not Alpha. That's good. That's my favorite topic. I was being a little bit sarcastic, because if you remember last year and the year before around this time, this is the time where we take a few weekends to talk about our financial situation. So you're in luck. If you're here today visiting, it's a bonus for you. You're getting we're going to have 3 weeks where we're going to reflect on our financial situation and the call to support that. Okay. I usually make jokes about this homily because, put it this way, when I give these homilies, there's a great reduction in the number of people who say, "Nice homily, Father." Just saying. On the way out. I make jokes about it, but here's the thing. We all know that, like, we're not children. That this is a significant part of our church, of the life of our church. And if we're going to fulfill the mission, we need to talk about it. So what I want to do this morning is I want to provide a big picture. I want to address the big picture situation of our parish. And I'm going to talk about four focal points in the life of our church that we have focused on, our parish leadership is focused on. Regular parish life, infrastructure, pastoral renewal, and outreach to the poor. First of all, regular parish life. You know, no matter how extraordinary our circumstances may be, to some degree, in every parish, there is always business as usual, because the Eucharist is celebrated, the sacraments are celebrated, funerals happen, outreach to the poor happens, and all the administration that goes along with parish life has to happen. We have to keep that going. So that's happening. But aside from that regular stuff, we as a parish of Our Lady of Guadalupe have a tremendous challenge ahead of us. And that has to do with these three areas. Number one, infrastructure. That's a fancy way of talking about our buildings. You know, the fishing boats. Up until a few months ago, our parish had 14 buildings in a 2-mile radius. 14 buildings. And the amount of work it takes to do the minimum amount of care and maintenance and respond to problems is absolutely enormous. But we inherited 14 buildings because of the merger of 5 communities that took place in January 1st. Because I know there's some people here who are new to our parish and might not know this history. We merged 5 parishes, 5 dying parishes, and we had all of these buildings. And so the weight of these parishes was huge, and we had to act. And we went through a whole process, a very difficult, painful process, discerning what we were going to do with our buildings. We discerned to have a 2-location parish, this location being a central location for Sunday Mass, and the North Dartmouth location to be outreach to the poor. And we made a decision to close and sell the 2 other locations. So this is a picture of the closing Mass at St. Paul's Church. This is a picture of the closing Mass at Immaculate Conception. Both these locations have been closed. Immaculate Conception has been sold, and the sale of St. Paul's will go through in the next 6 or 7 weeks. There's been a lot of work behind the scenes on this. Also, our infrastructure issue has to do with the work needed to be done on this location. This location was built almost 60 years ago. Even to restore it to its original glory costs a lot, costs millions of dollars. It's going to cost us millions to fix this place up to what it was. And what it was is not going to be enough for us. You know, we need to add to this building. So some of you may remember the dreaming process we went through about the building. I'm going to give you more information about that in a couple of weeks. So that's the infrastructure issue. The other is pastoral renewal. This is a picture of my Alpha small group at one of the last Alphas this year. This has to do about our need to invest in evangelization. As Pope Francis talked about, to be a parish that focuses on adult evangelization, adult discipleship. You see, for decades and decades, we invested in kids. And that was fine when we lived in a culture that was friendly to our faith. But it hasn't been working in a long time. We have the same phenomenon. We're used to it. We have children or young people go through sacraments. We never see them again. So we need to stop it. We need to stop doing what does not work. And we need to focus on adult evangelization, making disciples, investing in leadership. And we've been putting a lot of work and effort into that process. So that is ongoing. And finally, outreach to the poor. This church has a long history of serving the poor, especially the Society of St. Vincent de Paul. But when we merged parishes on January 1st, 2020, our parishes is huge, the location, and it includes the lowest income neighborhood in Atlantic Canada with a lot of poverty. And so we had a vision that the North Dartmouth location, under the leadership of Jen, put up your hand, Jen. There we go, there's Jen. Jen is doing a fantastic job. We had a vision of, because we can't afford to do this as a parish. Like, those are big buildings. Like, I'm going to show you this in a second. But we can do it through partnerships. If we partner with other churches, other community groups, we can use those buildings. Right now, we've got a food bank. We've got a house that houses men recovering from addictions. We've got a whole other number of partnerships that we're developing and growing with the dream to make it sustainable. So all of these things going on at the same time. That's the crazy thing. So we're doing the regular stuff. We've got to deal with the building issue because it's literally killing us. And we can't wait until the buildings are resolved before we tackle the spiritual. Because if we don't address the spiritual, pastoral reality, our church is going to keep shrinking and shrinking. The good news is that as we've invested in these things, our numbers are going up. Our Sunday attendance is now ranging between 600 and 700. A year ago, we were about 400 people, and the average age has come down, so that all the signs are pointing in the right direction. We're doing all of these things at once. Now, I want to give you a bit of a big picture with our parish finances, okay? How are you doing so far? You doing all right? It's not too boring, and I hope you guys online aren't bored. So here's something about the big picture. Now, through our ordinary and extraordinary revenue, our budget in this parish is about $1 million a year. Would you have guessed that? That's about $1 million. And last year, 2022, we finished with a deficit of $42,000. Now, that's just over 4%. It's about 4%, which is not bad, but it's not good. And one of the things is that was the increase in cost of buildings. The increased fuel costs. I'm not telling you something you don't know already. We've all experienced it, the increased cost in fuel. And we also were hit with a 50% increase in insurance premiums. I tell you, empty buildings cost a fortune. In 2022, our building expenses were 29% higher than the year before. And we winterized one of the locations. We turned the heat off, and we still paid 29% more. Do you know what 29% represented dollar-wise? Of course you don't. $82,000. $82,000. Do you know what we spent in 2022 on buildings alone? This is not major repairs. This is just basic maintenance. $361,000, folks. That's 50% of our regular income. That's $1,000 a day. That's what all these buildings are costing us, $1,000 a day. And it's taken us years to close them, going through a very difficult and painful process. Now, as we look forward at this year, at least back before the new year, the Finance Council put together a budget. And at that time, we forecast that this year we would have an $80,000 deficit. $80,000. Now, I'm hoping it will be less than that because we're going to be selling these buildings and moving them on, but this is our reality, and I thought it was time to share it with you that this is our reality. Now, there is great concern here because I believe we have a future ahead of us. But I will say this, we don't need to be alarmed. We have over $800,000 on deposit. We have money on deposit from the sale of Immaculate Conception. I want to be clear that the money from the sale of the buildings is going to be put aside because the renewal of this location with the purpose of serving the church in Dartmouth for the next 50 years, this is going to cost millions and millions of dollars. These things cost a fortune. I'm going to say more about that in a couple of weeks. So that money is going to be put aside. So we have money on deposit. And in speaking with the leadership team, the parish pastoral council, the finance council, and the archbishop, they're aware of this. In case you're thinking, is Father James just this crazy spender? You know, I hate having deficits. I haven't had really any deficits in my whole priesthood before. But we're in unusual times, having come through the pandemic and the merging of parishes. We have the support of the bishop and all of our leadership teams for this strategy, that for the meantime, it's okay for us to have a degree of deficits in the next couple of years. Now, obviously, that can't be a long-term strategy for us. We have to eventually balance things out. We have to live within our means. But I want to just speak to you about the big picture. The big picture looks slightly different because last year we worked with the city of Halifax to rezone many of our properties that in the future we can potentially sell. And we increased the potential net worth of our parish by about $4 million by simply rezoning these properties. So the big picture is okay, is good. But we're going to need all the resources we can get in order to do the renewal of this building. Okay. Now, some of you may say, well, if we're running this deficit, how come you have all these parish staff members? Maybe some of you have wondered about that. Well, I want to address that briefly because right now we have 12 parish staff, which is disproportionately large for the size of our parish, but I don't believe it's too large for the tasks that are before us. Now, before I arrived at this parish employed 5 full-time staff members. All of the member parishes that came together supported 5 full-time staff members. Here's the thing. Right now, of the 12 staff, only 5 of them are covered by regular income. Only 5. How is that? 3 of our parishioners are volunteer parishioners. Deacon David, Denise Trim, who's our operations manager, and Corinne, they work, they give a tremendous amount of time, they're amazing people, and they do it at zero cost to the parish. So 3 of our parishioners are volunteer. One of our parishioners is paid by Divine Renovation Ministry. It's a ministry I work for, and that's Anne-Marie. She's embedded here. She works half-time for the parish at no cost to us. 2 of the staff members are paid for by a special donation from several families that's not part of our regular income. Jen's salary, she's responsible for raising her own salary, so that doesn't come out of regular income either. In addition, Divine Renovation Ministry gives the parish $50,000 a year in compensation for the time that I put into serving that ministry. So I want to paint this picture for you of where we are right now. What we've done is we've tried to be incredibly creative to get ourselves, you know, it's like we've been stuck in the mud. We've got to get ourselves moving. Go back to those fishing boats, you know, we've got to get those boats into the water. And so we've been really, really creative about how we do this. Here's the thing. In the end, we have to do 2 things. We have to bring our expenses down. And I believe as we right size with our buildings, and we get the partnership in North Dartmouth going, our expenses will come down because that's our major expense are all the buildings. But here's the other piece. We need the income to go up. We need it to go up. I think we're quite a distance away from hitting our potential here at the parish. Here's the thing. This isn't about buying time. We're not interested in buying time. This is about becoming the church that God is calling us to be. This is about becoming the heart of Dartmouth. I believe we've got an incredible future ahead of us. If we play our part in what God is calling the universal church to for 2033, we need to deal with these matters. We need to address these matters. We need to get the fishing boats out of the sand and into the water and be about the mission that Jesus called us to. We heard in the second reading today these words from St. Peter, like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house. Like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house. This isn't simply about bricks and mortar. We need buildings, but it's not the most important thing. The most important thing is that we allow the Lord to build us into a spiritual house. St. Peter says, let the Lord do this. We have to give our consent. We have to give our yes to what God is doing. We have to say yes to being living stones. And so my ask of you today is to take ownership. Take ownership in every way. Don't be a bystander. Don't be a spectator. And part of that ownership is to take ownership of the finances. Someone after the 9 o'clock mass said to me, oh, Father, you have a deficit. We have a deficit, folks. We have financial challenges. I contribute weekly to the collection just like everyone else. I don't ask anyone to do anything I don't do myself. So it's together we have to own this and act accordingly. So I ask you to get behind what it is that we have to do. Don't sit in the sidelines, because I believe that by 2033 there's going to be an amazing story about how Our Lady of Guadalupe became the heart of Dartmouth.